Hello and welcome to ACCO Assembly of God's online service. Thank you so much for joining us today. If you could do me a favor, drop a comment below. Let us know that you're here. We would love to connect with you. And if this is your first time joining, welcome. We're so glad that you've chosen to worship with us this morning. Our online host will be putting a link to our digital connect card. We would love for you to fill that out so we can give you more information about the church or even answer any questions that you may have. We got an exciting Sunday happening here at ACCO Assembly of God. Today is our special business and vision meeting. And the business and vision meeting will be happening at 11:45 a.m. Now, we will be obviously doing it in person, but if you would like to join us online through Zoom, please email us at this time at info@accoag.com and we'll send you the link to that special meeting. It is not going to be a public link, so it is something that you'll have to ask and request for to be a part of. And if you are a member, please join us. We are voting on some special things today. But if you're not a member and just want to hear about the vision of ACCO Assembly of God, where we're headed in 2021, you are more than welcome to join as well. Something else we got exciting happening at the church is we do offer two different Bible studies every week. We just really want to be intentional about growing closer to God this year and really deepening our faith with Him. And we offer two different ways to do that. On Wednesdays, we have an in-person Bible study, and on Thursdays, we have an online Bible study. Both are from 7 to 8:15. We do send the link out to the online Bible study every week, the morning of, with the notes. These are just a great chance to get into God's Word, learn more about who we are in Christ, and just have an opportunity to fellowship with other believers. So please make it a point to join us this week. Something special that we're going to be doing on May 12th and 19th, it's a Wednesday night, both of those are Wednesday nights. From 7 to 8:15, we're gonna be doing a special workshop on how to read the Bible. Maybe you wanna learn how to get into God's Word for yourself, kind of make it a part of your daily walk with God. This is gonna be a great study on how to study the Bible. And the awesome thing is we're doing something for the very first time, is we're doing it in person, but we're also offering it online. So if you wanna join us through Zoom while we're meeting in person, you'll be able to do that. We will have an online host available, so if you have questions or want to interact in any way, they'll be able to have your question asked and stuff. So it's going to be a really great opportunity to just learn more about God's Word, how to study it for ourselves. So please make sure to join us for those special 2 weeks, the 12th and the 19th of this upcoming month. And finally, thank you so much for being faithful in giving. We are able to reach more and more people for Christ because of your faithfulness. And as always, just as a reminder, there's three different ways you can continue to give, either by mail, through our website, or through our app. All are completely secure and safe. Again, thank you so much for joining us today. And today we are getting into our next section of what is the gospel. We're gonna be talking about Jesus today. And so let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask Him to just bless today's service. Father, we thank you so much for who you are. You are a good God. You are faithful. Father, we thank you for your grace, your love, and your mercy. Lord, today as we learn more about your Son and the sacrifice that he made for us, Lord, I pray that the Holy Spirit would teach us, lead us, and guide us. Father, may we learn more about Jesus's role in the gospel message. May we learn more about his sacrifice and what he did for us so that we could experience life and relationship with you. Father, we pray this in your holy and precious Son's name. Amen.
Thanks again for joining us for our online service. I'm really glad that you're with us. If you've been with us the last couple of weeks, you know that we're on a sermon series called What is the Gospel? Based off of the book by Greg Gilbert, What is the Gospel? Every year we take a sermon series based off a book, and this is the book that we chose this year. This is a phenomenal book. I hopefully by now you have a copy of this book. Maybe you got it from Amazon or Christian Books. But listen, if you didn't, I have something I can send you. I call this a cheat sheet. Do you remember back in the 80s and 90s, something called Cliff Notes? Like you were supposed to read a really big, thick book in school. And instead of reading the really big, thick book, you bought the Cliff Notes and you'd read the Cliff Notes. I think if you are under the age of 35, you have no idea what I'm talking about. I'm obviously over the age of 55. But either way, these are the Cliff Notes. This is a kind of a condensed version of the book. Listen, I'd be happy to send this to you. It's a great track. It's a great understanding of everything about the gospel that we're talking about. So if you did not get the book, let me know. Just email me and I will send you one of these in the mail free of charge because I really want to get these things into your hand. They do phenomenal to help you grow in your faith, help you grow closer to Jesus. But not only that, really begin to understand what Jesus Christ has done for us, why we can have a relationship with God, our Creator. And you know what they also do? They help you to witness and to share Jesus with other people. I know a lot of times we're afraid to talk to other people about Jesus because we don't want to sound stupid or we're like, we don't have all the answers. And I understand that. But when you understand what the gospel message is, you can bring any conversation back to the gospel. And as long as you know what the gospel is, the four points of the gospel, you'll be able to lead someone to a relationship with Jesus Christ. So I really want to encourage you to do that. So if you remember, let's do a quick review. We talked about how the gospel has four points to it. The gospel message, four specific points. We kind of narrowed them down to God, man, Jesus, and then a response. And so last week, my wife talked about the man part, how we have sinned against God, we're guilty, and we deserve death. Doesn't sound like good news so far, does it? But it will today, because today we're going to deep dive into Jesus. We're going to deep dive into the gospel point that salvation is found in the sacrifice of Jesus, not in our own efforts. And we could approach this from a couple different ways. And here's what I want to answer the question today is this, is what does it mean that Jesus was our sacrifice? And if you notice, I capitalized the word our. And the reason I did that is because I want you and even myself to understand the gravity of the sacrifice that Jesus Christ made for us. I want you to understand the depth and the gravity of what he did for you, just like I want to understand it for me. And if you've been a believer for a while, I got saved when I was 12, so I've been a believer for many, many years. It's so easy to read what Jesus has done or even say, oh, Jesus did this, Jesus did that for me. And the weight of that really not have any effect on me. And so what we're looking for is we're looking for the Holy Spirit to transform our lives in a way that draws us closer to Jesus as we understand, as we get, as we grasp, and we have it deep in our heart of what Jesus Christ really did for us. And when we understand that, we begin to understand the gospel and it deepens our relationship with him. So we're going to look at three ways that answers this question. What does it mean that Jesus was our sacrifice? Now, I would say this, if you're not a believer, maybe you're not really sure about Jesus and you happen to be watching us today, I'm glad that you're watching. Keep watching. This is the best sermon series for you to learn what it means about why you should ask Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior in your life. Really is. And you make sure that you go back to our YouTube and our AccoAG.com and watch these other videos of last week's messages because you really need to understand the whole thing. It's really going to make a huge difference. Okay, let's jump in. What does it mean that Jesus was our sacrifice? Well, the first is this, that Jesus paid the price for our sins. Jesus paid my price and he paid your price for our sins. You and I, we had a debt that we could not pay. We couldn't afford the debt of sin in our life. We could put it like this. You and I, we are the ones who should have been crucified on a cross, not Jesus, because we deserve death because of the sin that's in our life. But Jesus sacrificed his life for you and for me. He paid our debt. Well, you know, in today's world, we could say, like, you and I are going to the electric chair. We're on our way to it. We're going to die. There's a debt that we owe. We can't pay it. That debt deserves death, so we're going to die. And right at the last minute, right before they set us in the chair, Jesus comes in and says, listen, I'm going to pay the price for you so you don't have to sit in that chair, so you don't have to die. He's going to take our place. He's going to take our sin, the penalty that we deserve, he's going to take it upon himself, and he's going to pay that price for us. Have you ever had somebody pay something for you? Pay a price that was so big. Well, how did you feel? Probably humble, probably filled with gratitude. That's what Jesus did. He paid a price that we couldn't pay. And in Peter, in 1 Peter chapter 2, it says this. He says, he committed no sin, no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled the insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might die to sin. This is written, a letter written by Peter. Remember, Peter was one of the disciples of Jesus. He lived with Jesus and walked with Jesus and talked with Jesus and for 3 years while Jesus was alive. This is the same person, same apostle, who denied Jesus 3 times. And so it's interesting, when you read this, we understand some character about Jesus. When Jesus was going to the cross, when they were beating him, abusing him, spitting on him, whipping him, he did not retaliate in any way. In other words, he allowed all that to happen. It was almost as if he was saying, I will have the affliction, give me all the pain of the sin of other people. It says he bore our sins upon himself on the cross so that we might die to sin. In other words, so that sin would have no hold on our life. He paid your price. He paid my price. He paid the debt that we could never pay. He stepped in and he did that for you and he did it for me. Let's look at some verses to help explain this a little bit better. In Romans chapter 6, verse 23, it says, for the wages of sin is death. In other words, when you sin, you deserve death. Whether you sin a little bit, whether you sin a lot, you deserve death. He says, but the gift of God is what? It's eternal life through our Jesus Christ, our Lord, through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21 says, God made him who had no sin. In other words, Jesus had no sin. He lived this life perfectly. And if you think about it, the only one who could pay for our debt filled with sin is someone who was sinless, someone who had no sin. And so Jesus took your sin upon himself. He took my sin upon himself. It'd be like you having stage 4 cancer. And the doctor says you have 2 weeks to live. Could you imagine that news? Probably some of you can imagine that news. You probably sat with a spouse or a loved one or somebody that you know that you were with when they received that news. And you know how you felt, and you basically knew that was a death sentence. And imagine at that point, somebody coming down, sitting across from you with that death sentence that you've been given of cancer and said, listen, if I touch you, you will be completely healed, and I will have that stage 4 cancer, and I will die for you. I will take the cancer from you and put it in my body. Now, we know that's not possible today, but that's what Jesus did for you, and that's what he did for me. And I think it's really important that we make this personal, that we really understand that he paid for my disobedience, that he paid for my sin, he paid for my pride, he paid for my rebellion, he paid for all of those things. He had no sin, but he became sin for you and me. He had no cancer. He had no death sentence, but he became cancer. He accepted a death sentence for you and me. And then 1 John 2:2 says this, for he is the atoning sacrifice of our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. This isn't just a whole world generic thing. It is, but we need to make it personal. He died for your sins and my sins. Now, maybe you've heard this before, that Jesus is an atoning sacrifice. I want to talk about this. There's a word called substitutionary atonement. This is a theological word that talks about that this is what Jesus did when he paid the price for my sins and your sins. We can kind of obviously break it down. I like to keep things simple. I like to break it down. You know, substitutionary or substitute means to exchange or to serve in the place of. So Jesus became our substitute. Jesus served in my place. Jesus substituted himself in your place when it comes to the wages of sin is death, when it comes to sin. And then to atone means to make amends. In other words, Jesus sacrificed himself, put himself in our place so we wouldn't have to, took our sins upon himself so that he could make amends, he could pay the price that would appease the wrath of God on sin in our life, and therefore restoring a relationship that we can have with our Father and our God and our Creator. That's pretty powerful when you think about it, that that's what Jesus did for you and that's what he did for me. Paul explains this in Romans chapter 5, verses 6 to 10. He says this, and I love this verse because it's very practical. He says, listen, he says, you see, at just the right time, while we were powerless against sin, in other words, we couldn't save ourselves, we couldn't help ourselves, he says, Christ died for the ungodly. That's you and me before Jesus. And then he says, very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person. Now he's talking about righteous. He's not talking about godly righteousness here. He's talking about like self-righteousness, like a prideful man, an arrogant person. You know people like that, right? That they're arrogant, prideful. You want nothing to do with them. So Paul makes a case. He goes, it's very rare that someone would die for a prideful man, an arrogant man, of someone who thinks they're better than other people. He says, but somebody might die for a good person. That could be, you would probably die for your kids, right? For you love your kids so much, you'd probably take their place if they were gonna die. It says, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this, and this is so important. He goes, while we were still sinners, while we were still powerless, while we were still sinning against him, in other words, in our disobedience, in our pride, in our arrogance, guess what God did? Because he loved us so much, Christ died for us. And he says, since we have been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? And then I love this last part because Paul makes this point. He says, for if while we were God's enemies, we were sinners, we were ungodly, we were his enemies. He says, while we were his enemies, he did everything to reconcile us to him through Jesus Christ, through the deeds of his son. Then he says, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? What's he saying? He's saying, listen, while you were an enemy of God, God loved you so much that he sent his son so that you could have a relationship with him. And now that you have a relationship with him, now that you've been reconciled with him, how much more is God going to give you life now that you have a relationship with him? Man, this is so powerful and so important to understand what Jesus has done for us. He took the place on the cross for you and for me. He paid our price when we couldn't pay it. Now let's go to the second point. The second point is this, is that Jesus gives us forgiveness of our sins. And I'm sure you've heard this before, that Jesus gives us forgiveness of our sins. It's probably nothing new, but it's so powerful. Have you ever been in a situation where somebody did something wrong to you, they hurt you, and so you forgave them? Or let's reverse it. Let's say you did something really bad, really wrong. You really hurt somebody you loved and you went to them. You didn't know if they were going to forgive you. And when you asked for forgiveness, they forgave you. Imagine how that made you feel. Like it probably made you feel humble. And probably you were full of gratitude. You're like, oh, thank you. Thank you so much for forgiving me. I'm so sorry for what I did to you. I'm so sorry, right? That's so important. Like, feel that forgiveness that Jesus gives us over our sin and our rebellion. And I think it's important. You know, there's a kind of a phrase that a lot of times we use, forgive and forget, right? Like, oh, I forgive and I forget it, right? Well, that's what God does. God forgives us and then he forgets about it. He doesn't bring it back up. It's gone. It's covered because of the sacrifice Jesus made on the cross. It's gone. Now, some of us, you know, we have this motto, oh, I forgive, but I'll never forget. Maybe you've even said that. And what's that mean? That means like you may forgive somebody, but you're not going to forget how they wronged you. You're not going to give them a chance to hurt you again. You're not going to give them an opportunity to wrong you, right? You forgave, but you're not going to forget. See, Jesus, when we talk about our forgiveness of sins, he forgives and he forgets. He doesn't hold us against. He doesn't hold us against us. He doesn't hold it back, anything back from us. He doesn't say, let's see you do it again. He doesn't do anything. He forgives and he forgets. He wipes the slate clean. Let's look at a couple of verses I think are so powerful. Matthew chapter 26, verse 26 to 28. I want to look at this. This is the Last Supper. This is where Jesus was at the Last Supper. He was actually at a Passover meal. And the Passover meal is, we can learn about what the Passover festival and feast is in Exodus chapter 12. And just to kind of give you a very tiny recap, the Passover festival that God instituted was simply to remind the Israelites, the Jewish people, of how he saved them out of Egypt. How the tenth plague was going to kill the firstborn of every child unless the Israelites took the blood of a perfect lamb and put it on the doorpost of their house. And the idea is that when death came, and it would not enter any house where there was the blood of a newborn perfect lamb on the house. And so that's why we get Jesus became our lamb. He's the Lamb of God. He became our Passover. Death passes over us. Why? Because of what Jesus did, because he paid the price for us and because he forgives us of our sins. And so this is the very last night Jesus was with his disciples. It was before he was betrayed. It was before he was crucified and before he rose again. The very last week of Jesus' life, we see that he's doing a Passover meal with his disciples. And so he's doing the traditional Passover meal, but when it comes time for the bread and the juice, or the bread and the wine, listen to what he says. He goes, while they were eating, Jesus took the bread and then he given thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples saying, take and eat, this is my body. It says, then he took the cup and when he given thanks, he gave it to them saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. And so when we talk about Jesus forgave us, Jesus died for us, shed his blood for us, and now, theologically, his blood covers all of our sins. So when God looks at you, he sees the blood of Jesus in your life, and because the blood of Jesus paid the price for your sins, you can now have the forgiveness of sins, not only your sins of the past, but the sins of the future. Whatever sins you commit in the future, they're covered by the blood of Jesus. It's finished. It's done. And I want to look at a couple of verses here. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 11 kind of answers the question, well, why did Jesus' blood have to be shed? In other words, what's the big deal about blood? In the Old Testament, we learned that in order for the nation of Israel on the Day of Atonement, there's that word atonement, for the nation of Israel's sins as a whole to be forgiven, they would take a goat, a lamb, they would sacrifice it, they'd put the blood into a chalice, take it into the Holy of Holies in the tabernacle. But why blood? What's the big deal about blood? Well, in Hebrews chapter 9, we understand what it's about. It says, in fact, the law requires that nearly everything be cleansed with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. There's no forgiveness of sins without the shedding of blood, because life is in the blood. And if the wages of sin is death, then in order for our sins to be forgiven against a holy God, blood must be shed. And so God instituted the whole animal sacrifice in the Old Testament. And when Jesus ushered in the new covenant or the New Testament, he gave himself as the Lamb of God. Our sins are completely and totally forgiven because he was the perfect sacrifice. There's no other sacrifices necessary. Psalm 103, 11 to 12 talks about God's love, and it talks about the forgiveness that we receive obviously because of the motivation of his love. It says, for as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. And I love this. Next part. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. You know what I think is really cool? Is that the psalmist could have said, as far as the north is from the south, he removes our transgressions. He removes our sin. But the interesting thing about north and south, if you start walking north, at some point, you're going to start walking south, right? You're going to get to the top of the earth, the very tip of, and then you're going to start going down. You will eventually start going south. So you can measure north to south. You can't measure east to west. If you start walking east, at what point do you start walking west? You don't. In other words, it's continual. It's infinite. In other words, so God removes our sins, our transgressions, our iniquities, as far as the east is from the west. In other words, it's immeasurable. That's how far God removes our sin. Praise God for that. That's exciting. That's good news right there, right? Let's continue on. In 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, John says this. He goes, if we confess our sins, see, there's something happens when we confess our sins to God. It says he is faithful and he is just and he'll what? Forgive us of our sins. And then he does what? He purifies us of all unrighteousness. The reason I love this verse because it says we can confess our sins to him. We want to continue to confess our sins to him. We want to continue to repent of the sins in our life so that there's not going to be anything between us and him in our relationship. No tension there. Ephesians 4:32 puts it this way. He says, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. This is a very important spiritual principle here. We are, as believers in Jesus Christ, we're called to forgive other people. Why? Because Christ Jesus, God forgave us in Christ Jesus. What's that mean? It means God loved us so much that he forgave the sins because of what Jesus has done. We didn't deserve the forgiveness, but because of what Jesus has done, we received the forgiveness. You know what? People who've offended you, people who've hurt you, people who've wronged you, they don't deserve your forgiveness. But you didn't deserve God's forgiveness either, but yet he gives it to you. And I think something that's so important for us to understand is that when we confess our sins to God, he is faithful, he'll forgive us, and he looks for us to in turn forgive others. So important, such an important concept. And I really believe that when you understand how much you're forgiven, how much God forgives you when you don't deserve it, it becomes so much easier for you and for me to begin to forgive other people in our lives when they don't deserve it. Such a powerful principle. And finally, the third one is this. Jesus gives us his holiness and righteousness. That you and I, we receive the righteousness and the holiness of Jesus in our life when we accept him as our Lord and Savior. Jesus' sacrifice on the cross, he gives me and you his holiness and his righteousness in our lives. Now let's talk a little bit about this. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 4 to 64, verse 6 says this. It says, all of us become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. We all shrivel up like a leaf, and like the wind, our sins sweep us away. Isaiah is telling us the condition that we find ourselves in, that our righteousness, our good deeds, the right things that we do, the good things that we do, compared to the holiness of God, our good deeds are like filthy rags. They're worthless. They're useless. Now, if you really want to deep dive into this a little bit more, and if you were not with us last Sunday, I really want to encourage you, go to our website, go to our YouTube channel, go to last week's message. My wife does a phenomenal job at really breaking this part down and how important this is. I'm not going to deep dive into this, but this is the condition we find ourselves in. The good things that we do are never going to be good enough that we would earn the right to be saved. The righteous works that we do, how much money we give to charity, how much time we volunteer, how much good things we do for other people, it's never going to be good enough in order to be saved by God. In other words, God's never going to look at our good works, our righteousness, and say, oh, you've earned it, here you go, because it will never. Our righteousness to a holy God is like filthy rags. It's useless. And 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, we read the first part of that a couple minutes ago. It says, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him, in other words, when we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we become in Christ. And he says, when we do that, he says, we become the what? The righteousness of God. We become God's righteousness. So in other words, the righteousness of Jesus Christ becomes ours. It becomes part of you and it becomes part of me. Look at what Paul says in Romans chapter 3, verse 21 to 24. He explains it like this. He says, but now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. Let's stop here. Let's talk about this real quick. Let's pull this apart. So we're talking about the righteousness of God, God's righteousness. It says, but now the righteousness of God, it's been shown, it's been manifested, it's real, it's kind of what he's saying. He says, apart from the law. In other words, the law tells us everything we need to do to be good enough, but we can never live out that law perfectly. Do you drive the speed limit every single time you're in a car? I don't. I break that law all the time. Now, some of you may break it once in a while. And so let's take the traffic laws. Maybe you break some of the laws, or maybe you break one of the laws one time every year. Just one little law. Maybe you park in the wrong spot. Maybe you go through a light. You know it's turning red, but you're going to say it was still yellow, and so you rush through it. Or maybe you do what I love. I do these at stop signs, a rolling stop, right? You just keep on rolling through it. You don't really stop. It's nighttime. Nobody's there. No harm, no foul. But you broke the law. And when we break God's law, if we break one of God's laws, it's like breaking all his laws. So he's saying that now the righteousness of God, what he's saying is that righteousness of God could never come by being good enough, by following the law perfectly. No, the righteousness of God, he goes, we can now have the righteousness of God. It's manifested apart, has nothing to do with the law. In other words, it's not by what we do. It's not by our effort that we have the righteousness of God in our life. That's what Paul's saying. And then he says this. He says, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. In other words, this righteousness that we have because of Jesus Christ, it comes through faith when we believe in Jesus Christ. And then he continues on. He goes, for there's no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. He's referencing that, you know what? Apart from the law, we cannot do anything. And then he says, and are justified by the grace as a gift. We didn't earn it, through the redemption that is in Jesus Christ. It's all because of the sacrifice that Jesus Christ made on the cross. The reason God can look at you and look at, the reason we can be in his presence is because we have God's righteousness given to us as we believe in Jesus Christ and accept him as our Lord and Savior. There's actually a word for this called imputed righteousness. This is the theological word. This is what Jesus Christ has done for you and for me. It says, when we talk about this imputed righteousness, it means the righteousness of Christ is imputed or is ascribed to, is given to, is laid upon you to believers, so that believers are treated as if the righteousness of Christ is actually their righteousness through faith in Christ. It is on the basis of Jesus' righteousness that God accepts us in the first place. That's what we call justification, making us right before God. We're made right before God because we're now righteous before him. How did we become righteous? By keeping the law? No, because we've received Christ's righteousness, Christ's holiness in our life because we believe in Jesus Christ through faith. That's what the sacrifice he's done for us. Now, let me show you another verse here, Philippians chapter 3, verse 9. Paul says this, and being found in him, in other words, and being found in Jesus, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law. In other words, I'm not being a good person. It's not my goodness that I get this righteousness from. He says, no, it comes through faith in Christ. The righteousness from God that depends on faith. In other words, when I have faith in Jesus Christ, I accept him as my Lord and Savior, his righteousness is imputed to me. It's ascribed like it's mine. That's why the Bible says, be holy because God is holy. That's why the Bible says you're now a chosen generation. You're now a saint, no longer a sinner, because he gives you the righteousness of Christ in your life. This is so important and so powerful. This is also why we say that salvation only comes through Jesus Christ. Salvation only comes through Jesus Christ. Because Jesus paid the price for our sins. He took our sins and then he paid the price for them. He paid the debt that you and I couldn't pay. And then Jesus, he gives us forgiveness of sins. Nothing else in this world, no one else in this world can forgive you of the sins that you commit against your Creator, except your Creator. And Jesus then gives us his holiness and his righteousness. Like, just think, if he just paid the price for us, that'd be great, right? But that wasn't enough. He then forgave us of our sins. Forgive and forget. Forgave completely. Doesn't even bring them back to us. Doesn't even accuse us. Remember when you did this? No. He forgives and he forgets. And then what's he do? Then he gives us his holiness, his righteousness. That's why salvation only comes through Jesus. Now, we don't have time to go into it, but I did put some scriptures down here. John chapter 11, verse 25, Jesus is like, I'm the resurrection, I'm life. John 14:6, he says, listen, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. Acts 4:12, there's only one name that you'll be saved, and that's Jesus. Even in Philippians chapter 2, verse 9-11, talking about every knee will bow, every tongue is going to confess it. Jesus is Lord. There's only salvation through Jesus Christ. That's it. That's the good news of Jesus, or the good news of the gospel. The good news is that he paid your price. He took your place on the cross. He has forgiven you of your sins, forgive and forget, and he now gives you his righteousness and holiness so that you can live for him. Man, that is such good news. Last week wasn't so good. This week, good news, right? Let me pray for you. And listen, if you have a relationship with Jesus, and maybe you've been saved for 20, 30 years like I have, praise God. I just hope the gravity and the depth of the understanding of what Jesus Christ has done for you. You know what I hope it does? I hope it does the same thing that it did to Peter when Peter got a glimpse of the divinity of Jesus, when he got a glimpse of the holiness of Jesus Christ and who he really was. Do you remember that scene? Do you remember where Peter was fishing all night and Jesus rolls up and says, Peter, let's go fishing. And Peter says, look, Jesus, I've been fishing all night. There's no fish out there. But because you're my teacher, I will go. And they go fishing. Jesus says, stop. Jesus says, throw your net overboard. Peter throws his nets overboard. And the Bible says that he started to catch such a great multitude of fish. All these fish were in these nets and they're bringing them in that he had to call the other boats over. And all these other, and if you read it, it's in Matthew. It says Peter stopped. And then it says he fell to his knees. He looked at Jesus and he said, get away from me, Jesus. I am a sinner. Oh, such an important moment and experience for Peter when he realized the gravity of his sin compared to the holiness of Jesus Christ, the holiness of God. And it's the same with us. If you're a believer in Jesus, my prayer for you is that you understand the gravity of the sin and you repent and you turn to God and you keep that relationship fresh and you keep that relationship vibrant and alive and that you understand the depth of what Jesus Christ has done for you. If you don't have a relationship with Jesus, or maybe you've been running from Jesus, my prayer for you is that you would just turn and come back to him. He's waiting there with open arms. He's ready to forgive and forget. He wants you to be holy and righteous before him. He wants you to be part of his family. Let's pray. And then I got a couple announcements afterwards. Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, I thank you for your gospel message, which is good news to us. Lord God, I pray in the name of Jesus that we would understand the sacrifice that you made for us and what that means. We'd understand the gravity and the depth of it, Lord God, and that we would turn away from our sin and that we would turn towards you, that we would declare you as our Lord and our Savior. We'd ask you to be our Lord and Savior of our life, to lead us and guide us, Lord God. We want to love you more and more each and every day. Come into our life, make us whole. We love you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you so much for being with us. A couple quick announcements. The online host talked about the digital card, or my wife did a little bit ago. Listen, fill that out for us. If you have any prayer requests, you want to be connected with us a little bit more, you gave your life to Christ for the first time, let us know. Just click that link. The online host will be putting it in again now. You can also find it in the bio of this video afterwards, but we'd love to connect with you and engage with you. And then also, don't forget, 11:45, we're going to be starting our annual business meeting and vision meeting. So listen, if you're going to be watching from online, here's my encouragement. Make sure you click the link to Zoom about 5 to 10 minutes before. We will be on about 15 minutes before, making sure everything's up and running. You need to get on. You need to make sure you can hear. We'll be playing music, be able to hear everything, be able to see everything. You won't be able to talk audibly, but you will be able to chat with us. If that's the way, if you have any questions, you can let us know and we'll ask them during the meeting. But it's important for you to get your computer and everything ready to go. You can use your phone for Zoom. You're more than welcome to. But I will say we're going to be showing some a lot of documents and different things on the screen behind us. And so you may not be able to see the TV as well because we're going to be putting it on the big screen, on the projection screen. So you might want to make sure that you have put this on a computer instead of you know what I'm saying, right? I'm sorry. Basically, you can do it on a phone. I'd encourage you to do it on my computer. I should have just said that. Would have been much simpler. All right, I got Jesus running through my mind. I'm so excited about what he's done for us. So listen, we love you. We care about you. And I hope you'll join us for the meeting. Even if you're not a member, we'd love for you to know what's going on at our church. And we'd love for you to be a part of it. So God bless you. We love you. Have a great week.